Welcome to the S&P Weekly. This episode...
What does that stand for?
Salty Nerd Podcast.
Are we starting?
Branding.
No, we're going to start right now. Welcome to the Salty Nerd Podcast, episode 5. S&P Weekly, episode 5.
It comes after 4.
Yeah, comes after 4.
6.
I can't believe we're at 4
one
already.
Hand. It's got 5 digits.
1, 2, 5.
How old are you? I'm 5.
Today's episode, we have some great news, some cool topics. I think this is actually going to be fun to talk about. Like last week,
for
kind of.
Change?
Yeah. Last week.
The other 4 episodes not been fun.
Well, last week kind of felt like a chore because we were talking about Watchmen, which I didn't really care about, and then a couple other topics. I was like, okay, let's just chew through this. But this week, we have Mandalorian trailer, which looked awesome. We have some fantastic news in the Star Wars community. And then we also have our discussion of Hill House, which I know we've all been looking forward to. And we've
some
all been
Game of Thrones stuff.
That's, yes, and Game of Thrones. Mm-hmm. That's right. This is going to be fun.
All 4 corners of the geek culture.
Yes.
Covered in one episode.
This is going to be so much fun. All right, let's start with the Mandalorian trailer. Freaking awesome, right? We actually get to see the guy talk.
You shill. How dare you?
No, I don't care. It's awesome. It's an awesome trailer.
I hope that Disney paycheck goes a long way.
I can't even afford new mics. What are you talking about? It looks great, man. Pedro Pascal looks amazing in the role. He's got that like we talked about before, he's got that Clint Eastwood feel to him. I'm digging everything about it. And there was a couple of shots that I caught on to because I was watching this trailer in like super slow motion so I could take screenshots for my Instagram.
What a nerd.
Yeah. And I caught a glimpse of some prequel era battle droids and a prequel era spaceship, the missile launching spaceship from the Clone Wars, the big round flying saucer things. I thought that was crazy. I did not expect them to have that included because this is taking place after Return of the Jedi. So we're many, many years separated from the Clone Wars and the Separatists and all that stuff. But here they are, battle droids walking around what may be Mandalore. What did you think, Matt? I'll start with you, Vader. What did you think about it?
I really didn't think about what planets they were on. I think you're way more diving into that more than I did. But yeah. I thought the trailer looked great. I thought it was fantastic looking, and I did not notice any battle droids from the Clone Wars, but I'm gonna have to go look again.
I'll show you right now. Let me just pull up that picture on my phone.
You know, they've only got so many old droids in the Lucasfilm warehouse. They got to use those things, make them work.
I think my theory is it's a flashback, and the Mandalorian is the young child. So the last 2 trailers that we've had, there's been a key moment where the camera focuses on a young child who's in trouble and distress, and then somebody has to rescue them. I think the child in the beginning that's wearing the red outfit is probably the young Mandalorian, and his home city gets taken over by the Separatists or something like that. Maybe his parents die, and that sets him on some kind of a revenge quest against the person who might be in charge of that. Maybe. This is all speculation. I have no idea. Kadish, what did you think?
I really liked the second trailer. I've liked all the trailers for this show so far. The beginning was kind of more of the same that we've seen in the past, but then they showed us some new stuff. It really does. You mentioned Clint Eastwood before. It really does feel like one of those Man with No Name or Pale Rider type stories where you have like the wandering cowboy who comes into a town and he has to fight the evil, corrupt, ranchers or whatever. But this one, it's obvious that, the Mandalorian, the main character, he's going to be in a situation where, he's kind of like this loner who's a mercenary going out collecting bounties, and he's going to be put in a situation where he has to become the good guy, basically. I think that's basically what they're setting up here. I also think it's interesting to note that his armor seems to be phasmatized, where a laser blast just kind of bounce off of it.
So he's I noticed that too.
A little bit invincible in this trailer, which I think is kind of cool.
In canon, Mandalorian armor is exceptionally powerful, right? So there's a reason for that, at least. They're not just making him OP because he actually does have the Mandalorian armor. And I think in that one of the San Diego Comic-Con, they had a couple of minutes of footage where they showed him and they were in payment, instead of taking money, he was taking a chunk of metal, that special metal from Mandalore, I think, which is extremely valuable. So he was going to use that for his armor or something like that. There's some kind of something there.
I also need to point out that Bill Burr, one of my favorite comedians, made a little cameo here as a bounty hunter. I had no idea he was in this show, so I'm very excited about that aspect of it.
I'm surprised they'll let him near it.
But I'm really hoping that they never take off the helmet and we never see his face.
I totally agree.
I really hope that.
What would be the point of casting him if they never take the helmet off?
Well, that's your typical Hollywood thinking. It's like, we got to show the star's face at some point. But I really hope they just do Judge Dredd it.
Yeah.
Where the character is the helmet, and he never takes it off. Because if they take it off and they show it as a real person, that's going to ruin some of the mystique, I think. I'd really rather prefer that they just keep him mysterious.
Yeah, I totally agree. The comparison to Judge Dredd with Carl Urban, that was a fantastic movie. I think that was
Carl
a great
Urban
way.
Himself, he made that decision. He's like, I don't want to take my helmet off. Judge Dredd never takes his helmet off.
Yeah.
And, that's a big risk. It was kind of the same thing with The Dark Knight Rises, although they kind of wussed out towards the end there where they showed Tom Hardy. But... with Bane, they never show Bane's full face for that one scene. So I think that there's definitely something to be said about, staying true to the character they envision. And part of that is not showing the guy's face, even though Pedro Pascal, he's not a big star, but he's recognizable. So I kind of hope that they kind of stick with this, he seems the type of guy who doesn't say a whole lot, so.
Well, he actually speaks in this trailer.
He speaks at the end, but that's the only thing we've ever heard him say.
Yeah.
And Clint Eastwood's characters, in his movies never really spoke a whole lot.
Yeah, very, very chosen phrases and words and stuff like that. I think if they follow through with that, I totally agree. I think that's going to be the best way to go, at least for the first season. I wouldn't be opposed to them changing things up for later on the second season and stuff like that if they want to build on the character a little bit more. But for the first season, I totally agree. I think they should.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this show, it looks like Star Wars. It feels like Star Wars. I'm excited for it.
Yeah, me too. Are you excited?
I am very excited.
Awesome.
It's very cool to finally have some Star Wars
to be excited about.
To be excited about. Yes, sir.
And they've also got a really good cast for it.
Yeah.
The guy from Breaking Bad, Carlos Esposito, is that his name? The guy who played Gus Fring.
Oh, yeah.
He's the main bad guy in the show. You got Carl Weathers.
Yep.
You got, what's her name, Gina Carano?
Gina Carano. She's awesome. I love her.
American Gladiator.
Yeah. She was. She had a movie that she did a while back. Haywire. It was called Haywire. Yeah. I actually really liked that movie. It was a lot of fun to watch.
It was okay. Steven Soderbergh kind of, he's hit or miss with me. But, she was good in it. And, she was kind of tossed around for Wonder Woman.
That was my briefly. Vote. Before they cast
Gal Gadot? She's got the physicality for sure.
Yeah.
Not quite up to par on the acting chops.
No, I'll give you that. She's definitely
as
good.
As long as she, plays those strong, badass chick roles, she'll be fine.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I agree. I think she did really good in Deadpool, too. I mean, that was a perfect character for her. Didn't talk a lot. Very strong. Had a lot of personality, just physicality-wise. Not necessarily the strongest actor, but she's working her way up and she's taking on better and better projects. And I'm glad that she's part of this show. I think it's going to be really cool. A lot of fun.
The special effects looked really good.
Movie quality.
Yeah, movie quality.
Absolutely.
It's spectacular. And I love how they're really leaning on the practical effects. You got a really close look at the aliens in the bar during this one.
Yep. The fight choreography was really well done.
Yeah.
He seems to have that kind of shoot from the hip, quick draw.
Yeah, it's very Western.
Mm-hmm. It's very Western.
Yeah.
And they're getting the nostalgia feels for us old guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
Familiar looking aliens and ships.
It almost feels like this, they're doing something that Solo should have done in terms of the aesthetic of the show.
Maybe they are. Maybe they're doing that very much on purpose.
Yeah.
It's possible.
I think they are making corrections. I mean, we can see that behind the scenes and with some of the recent news that we'll talk about in a minute. But I wanted to mention one more thing. There's a character in this show that's played by an actor named Dominic Pace, who actually ended up in the trailer. He's super excited. He did a little video yesterday thanking Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni for including him. He's in the bar scene where you see the two bounty hunters. One is like a blue guy and the other one's a chick. And they kind of look at the camera or look towards the Mandalorian. In the background, you see Dominic Pace's character. He's got like horns on his head. He's kind of a bounty hunter type guy. Right there. You see him. Anyway, yeah, he was right there. We're watching the trailer right now. But I'm super stoked that he made it into the trailer, which means he most likely will actually have a decent chunk in the show itself. And I'm super excited for him. He's really super Star Wars nerd. And, he did an interview with the Scarif podcast guys. So
they also, didn't they tap the 501st, the Stormtrooper cosplay group?
Oh, I'm sure they did.
Did they?
Yeah, because they needed so many Stormtroopers. Yeah. They didn't have the budget to do all the costumes for it.
I got to tell you, look, watching this trailer over Salty's head here, this is set after
Return of the Jedi.
Right? So those are some pretty haggard looking Stormtroopers.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you notice?
I think they're kind of, I don't think they're like your normal Stormtroopers. I think these guys are like mercenaries. They're like probably some kind of.
They're definitely some kind of remnant, like leftovers who just kind of stuck to their guns.
So you think maybe Carlos Esposito's character has broken off with loyalists to him and he's like kind of.
Maybe. Yeah.
Yeah.
That would be kind of cool. Over a outer rim planet or something.
Yeah, I think so. He's very much going for that. Like, because I think he's a Moff. His character actually has a Moff title, so he's definitely taking advantage of the fall of the Empire and is trying to rise in the ranks during the chaos. Because you know, chaos is a ladder.
Yeah. Also, IG-88.
Nobody else got that joke.
No, I got it.
I just didn't think it was funny.
You're just trying to make me feel dumb, Salty.
Were you trying to do a segue? Was that the?
It's too early for the segue, but yes, it would have been a good one.
IG-88 is actually voiced by Taika Waititi.
I don't think it's IG-88.
It's IG-11.
Well, whatever. IG-whatever.
Come on, man.
The one that looks like IG-88.
Get your shit together, Kadish.
Hold on. What's the theory? They can't name it IG-88 because then they got to send George Lucas a check in the mail?
Yeah, that's a pretty ridiculous theory.
It's like the 25% dewbacks that aren't on Tatooine.
Yeah.
So. You see, like, the funny thing is like that 25% thing. So, like, that was a rumor, or not rumor, that was actually a legal definition for Star Trek.
Yeah.
Because there were two different companies that were dealing with the licenses. With Disney owns the Star Wars license outright. So, they don't need to change anything if they don't want to. So, that rumor is just completely silly.
All right. Is that everybody's thoughts on the Mandalorian trailer?
Well, we're only, 2 weeks away from the first two episodes?
2 weeks away. Yeah,
drops on November 12th. I'm trying to figure out, like, I don't have the option to, like, download the app yet. So I want to put it on the TV, but I have to be able to download the app on the TV to get Disney+.
Probably November 12th.
You think they're going to wait?
How long is it going to take you? Push a button, it goes, bzz, bzz, and then you have it there, man. It's ready to go.
Yeah, but, like, come on now.
Then it goes, go online and get that 8-digit code.
Just push the code in. Stay off Twitter until you watch the episodes because they will spoil the crap out of it.
Oh, it's going to get watched like the second I have that service.
Yeah, definitely. So, I know I'm at least part of two podcasts that are going to be doing breakdowns of that every week.
And I know that for the first episode of Watchmen, like just in my Twitter feed alone, like every 2-bit movie news site was spoiling.
I'm just going to start making crap up about that show and posting stuff on Twitter about
it. You should tell them that they have an orange president.
Yeah.
And he's like some kind of alien or something like that.
You're the only one watching it now, right?
He's an orange Jabba character. Yeah.
All right. The next topic we have, talking about Star Wars still, Benioff and Wiess, they announced last night, are leaving their trilogy. They are no longer producing or writing a Star Wars trilogy. Two things that I speculated about their trilogy is, well, not speculated. The one that they announced was it was coming out in 2022, 2024, and then 2026. Those were the three slated dates for the release of the movies. So that's not happening anymore. And then the other thing...
Well, those dates are still reserved for Star Wars movies.
Maybe. Well, they're like...
No, that's Disney's schedule.
They're leapfrogging Avatar, right?
Yeah.
So if they still, I mean, that's not a lot of time to start from scratch, but we'll talk about that in a minute. And the other thing was the actual story behind it. There were speculations and leaks and all this other nonsense about what their trilogy was going to be about. They were going to be talking about the ancient Sith and the ancient Jedi, like long, long before when they first kind of became rivals on, was it Dathomir or what was the planet where the Sith came from? It was actually a species called the Sith, right? Mm-hmm. And they turned to the dark side. So they were kind of going for that that medieval vibe, I think, is what they were kind of tossing that to Benioff and Wiess because of their work on Game of Thrones. And now Benioff and Wiess signed this like $500 million deal with Netflix, and they were like, oh, our schedules are still filled up. We don't want to work on Star Wars anymore. So do you think that's the truth?
That is such trash.
Or do you think that Disney was like, hey, guys, season 8 sucked. You're out. Kadish, what did you think?
So a little bit of inside baseball stuff here. So after Game of Thrones, Game of Thrones was winding down, Benioff and Wiess basically start shopping their services around to other studios outside of HBO. And this is pretty typical. You know, J.J. Abrams famously did that before, right after he kind of finished or signed on to start doing Episode 9. His deal with Paramount, J.J. Abrams' deal with Paramount, kind of ran out, and so he started shopping himself around, and Warner Brothers ended up giving him a overall deal for $500 million. So Benioff and Wiess were kind of shopping around their services in much the same way, and basically Netflix ended up wooing them over for a $300 million overall deal.
Now, was it three? I thought it was five.
I think it was 300.
Oh, okay.
It could be 500. My memory might be fuzzy on it, but I think it was definitely at least, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars. And so basically what an overall deal is, in Hollywood, you have these things called first look deals, which is, if you have a first look deal with a studio, basically you show your project to them first, and they have the right to either make it first or refuse it. And then after they refuse it, you can go off and pitch it to other places, but you have to pitch it to them first. Now, what an overall deal is basically it's an exclusivity deal. So you can pitch it. You have to do a first look deal with that studio. So like you'd have to pitch it to Netflix first. But if Netflix doesn't want to do it, you can't take it anywhere else. So it's basically dead. So Benioff and Wiess have this overall deal with Netflix where basically for 5 years they're getting $300 million to produce whatever the heck they want. And when it comes to Star Wars, you have basically the situation where they went into this deal with Netflix with three movies on their plate, essentially, that they had to write, produce, and possibly direct. And as Alex stated earlier, Disney has this release slate for Star Wars, which is over the next, like, what, 6 years, 7 years, something like that.
6 years.
And when it came down to it, basically, Benioff and Wiess, I think, had to make a choice where if they were going to focus on the movies, all their Netflix stuff was going to take freaking forever to get off the ground. And Netflix probably wasn't going to be too happy about that, considering that they just handed over $300 million.
Ton of money.
So what I think happened was I think Netflix made it clear to Benioff and Wiess that they needed to be a priority. And Benioff and Wiess basically said, you're right. And I think they went to Disney and they said, like, look, we can't handle both these deals, so we're just going to, you know, back out on this. And I think Disney knew about this for some time. And that's why we got the Kevin Feige announcement and all this stuff. Because if Kevin Feige is good at one thing, it's about, you know, getting productions off the ground and running. So my guess is that they're going to be using him to kind of at least do like the first release slot in
2022.
Yeah, I think that's going to be Feige's job to get a movie ready to go by then, and then possibly assemble the team to hand it off to so they can go off and fill in the other release slates. But I don't think it was a situation where Disney was like, season 8 of Game of Thrones sucked, you're fired. I think it was...
Well, that's what I'm thinking in my head.
Okay? Well, I think a lot of people see that, but I think it really just came down to Netflix gave them a ton of money. They had to prioritize Netflix, and they couldn't handle both a trilogy of films and their $300 million overall producing deal with Netflix at the same time. I think it's as simple as that.
Really. Okay. So you think the official story is actually the truth, where they're like, yeah this is just too much on our plate. We have other obligations. Yeah,
especially considering how bad of producers Benioff and Wiess are.
I really hate it when Kadish comes in here and uses logic.
No, that's awesome. No, that's good. That's, that's good.
Normal thinking.
Because you know,
just really knock me off my perch.
The last
really
thing,
annoys me when he does that.
The last thing that I want is for the Salty Nerd podcast to be like part of the fake news YouTube crowd. So that's cool. Yeah, I'm glad that you kind of cleared that up for us. That's actually good news. I'm still glad that they're not attached to Star Wars.
I think if I was them, I would just go to the bookstore and just find some cool like fantasy books and have them turned into movies or TV shows. Because they can adapt stuff really good. They just can't write really good.
Yeah.
So,
one of the interesting things I learned recently was David Benioff, the good-looking one. His father ran one of the biggest investment banks in the world, Goldman Sachs. He was the head of Goldman Sachs.
What?
And he was personal friends with the guy who ran HBO. And so his father's connection with the head of HBO was what got him in the door with the original Game of Thrones pitch, because he had never produced anything. He'd never... actually made any like films or TV shows. He had no production experience whatsoever. But because his dad ran the biggest investment bank in the world, and a lot of these studios get loans and stuff from Goldman Sachs, so like this guy wielded a lot of power. So Benioff's dad was the only reason Game of Thrones got made.
That's bananas. That is so crazy.
That's absolutely crazy. And it's one of the reasons why these talentless hacks were able to actually, get a foothold in the industry, because anyone with that lack of experience would never have gotten, a deal with HBO at the time that they got this deal.
So going. What you're saying is Hollywood is just like Las Vegas.
It's nepotism.
Where you got to know people to get the good jobs.
Yeah.
So
sounds like it.
Yeah.
So it's like everywhere then, basically. Yeah. It's all about who you know. That's crazy though that they're... They had that interview, right, recently where they kind of spilled the beans. They were like, oh, yeah, we had no idea what we were doing half the time.
Well, that wasn't a big secret, though, because everyone knew from the beginning that they had no experience doing this stuff. And HBO just surrounded them with a team of very competent people to handle the nitty-gritty of the production logistics. These guys basically just wrote the scripts and sent them out and stuff like that, and then let the professionals handle the day-to-day nitty-gritty stuff.
Which, what a team, right? I hope the same team that was working on the Game of Thrones show for the past 8 seasons, which is phenomenal, is working on this new show that they just announced. HBO had this announcement last night. They kind of confused me because they first announced that one of the prequels was canceled. There was a prequel that was speculated to be called either The Long Night or Age of Heroes. The Blood Moon. There was like 3 different titles floating around that I saw, and that was canceled. It was not picked up. They did a pilot.
Get your terminology straight.
Sorry, man.
God.
So basically,
they did a pilot for it, and they were like,
the way TV works is if you have a new series that you want to put on a network, the network will do a proof of concept, basically, where they order a pilot episode, and they'll spend a couple $1 million on this pilot to see if the show is going to work. And if the pilot is good, they'll order it to a series and they'll make more episodes and they'll release the season. And if the pilot is bad, they'll cut their losses and just move on.
Yep.
And so initially, after Game of Thrones ended, they had 5 different spinoffs kind of in the works in the development phase. And the one that kind of got fast-tracked and got a pilot order really early on was this a series called Blood Moon, which was going to be basically about set like 1,000 years during the events of the Game of Thrones.
During the Age of Heroes, right? And they were talking about the origin of the White Walkers and all that stuff.
Yeah, it was leading up to the Long Night and stuff like that. And they cast Naomi Watts in a Lannister role, I think. She was going to be like the main character.
The Lannisters weren't around back then, though, were they?
Yeah, they were.
1,000 years before Game of Thrones? Because the guy that stole Casterly Rock was fairly history.
All I know is that it was very Lannister-esque. so basically, they went out and they made this pilot, and supposedly the production was very troubled. There was a lot of kind of infighting going on, and from what I understand, it was basically like Downton Abbey in Westeros. It was just very boring.
I thought it was going to be a show about the little tree kid people.
Children of the Forest?
Yeah, you know, the little tree people.
So anyway, so this show, apparently when they did the pilot, it didn't make the cut. But there was another show that was taking place a little bit more recently in the Game of Thrones history during Aegon's conquest, which is about 300 years before the events of the TV show that we know and love. And Aegon's conquest is pretty much spelled out like really, really well. There's a ton of source material. The story is like very plainly put.
Yeah, based on there's Fire tons, and Blood.
Yeah, based on the book Fire and Blood.
Or the book, yeah.
So there's a lot of source material for them to use to fall back on. George R. R. Martin is involved in this one as well.
And it's complete.
And it's right? Yeah, it's done. So there's no like leaving them hanging in the last season or anything like that. So this can actually be really cool. I like Aegon's Conquest is a pretty fascinating story. It kind of sets up where these houses that we've learned about in the Game of Thrones show, like the Baratheons, how they got into power, the inner workings of the Lannisters with the Targaryens and how they became so close because we know Tywin was very close to the Mad King. And of course the Starks, their Starks were still around. They were the Wardens of the North, and it was a well-known story. I think it was, the King Who Knelt. And who talked about that the most often? Was it the little girl with Davos who taught him how to read? She was telling him all these stories about the past, about Aegon's conquest and all that stuff. I think it was her. Anyway, what was her name? I feel bad not remembering. Shireen. Poor girl. She didn't deserve to die that way.
Yeah, she's still alive in the books, though.
Oh, that's good.
Spoiler.
Anyway, so this is actually – I'm really excited for this because it's actually going to talk about the construction of the Iron Throne, and it's got all this inner working politics with all these different families, a ton of battles. Like there's a friggin' battle every week in this story according to this video that I watched. Like every single family that falls to the Targaryen rule has some kind of a battle involved except for the Starks and a few others. So it's going to be action-packed. It's going to be a lot of the familiar families that we have seen before, and I'm super excited for this. Vader, what do you think?
I'm super excited for this. I think it's a great concept for HBO series especially. You know, they're going to be able to do all kinds of cool stuff with this, you know, and we'll be able to see some stuff on this show that we wanted to see on the old show, like Valeria and, you know, how it crashed and burned.
Because it'll be right after the fall of Valeria.
Yeah, I hope they can at least do some maybe flashback episodes and set everything up with that.
Because the reason why Aegon ended up in Westeros in the first place was because of the fall of Valeria. So we may see some kind of a setup or flashback about that. Show them coming over to Westeros and setting up Dragonstone. Was it Dragonstone? What was the name of
this? Yeah. He was kind of a rebel, right? He got some kind of prophecy.
Yeah.
And said, get out before the
There's world ends. Two theories to that. There's a theory that he got a prophecy from some black magic witch lady, or he did something wrong and he was going to be put to death and his whole family was going to be killed. So he just took off and left.
Kadish is over here side-eyeing me because I'm not a book reader and I'm probably getting everything wrong.
We're probably both getting everything wrong.
Oh, yeah, it was terrible.
I'm going to have to – see, this kind of sucks though because I'm going to have to read the books now. Like I was like – I watched Game of Thrones. I'm like, okay, I've seen the show. I don't really – you know, it's over now. I don't have to read the books or anything. But now they're coming out with a new one and I'm like, oh, crap. Now I got to watch
I actually have decided that I'm going to read the books.
Yeah?
Because
– You can read?
I can read. I can read slowly. You know,
just go to audible.com.
I think I read the Lord of the Rings trilogy 3 times trying to get through it once. But – I'm going to go back and read the books.
That's so
simply
true.
Because, you know, book readers like my brother, for example, he lets me know that there's all kinds of stuff in those books that aren't in the shows.
Yeah.
And of course the books are going to end completely different. I have a feeling than what the show did.
And pretty much if he ever gets it out. After the third book, so, it's drastically different.
Yeah. So you might as well read the books.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I'm down. I'm excited for it. It's going to be cool.
I'm not going to do a book report or nothing about it on YouTube.
You're not going to report back to us on the SMP Weekly and just tell us all about the books?
My goal is to have them read before I die.
Okay.
So
hopefully he has them written before he dies. Kadish, what do you think about this series?
Unlike you two, I think this is a terrible idea.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I am not excited for this at all. I think it's a big misstep. So one of the fantastic things about Game of Thrones, and one of the reasons I think that it kind of caught on the way it did, was the fact that no one was safe. You didn't know, like, you could have a hero who fit all the typical archetypes of a hero, of a main character, and all of a sudden they could be killed off, and you'd be like, oh my god. And so eventually it became this tapestry of characters that you cared about, but you were in constant fear of, like, what was going to happen, because you didn't know. Well, when you're doing a prequel, one of the problems is you know what's going to happen. So, like, we know that Aegon, you know, conquers Westeros. We know he survives. We know him and his sisters don't die, you know, all this stuff. We know exactly who dies and how they die. We know the outcome of every battle. So, like, even though it would be cool to see some of this stuff, you know, be introduced to new characters and see these battles, the fact of the matter is like, it pretty much saps all the tension out of the show, because we know who's expendable and who isn't. I would have rather seen them do something like, okay, well, we're 100 years after the events of the Game of Thrones show that we just saw, and there's a new supernatural threat. That's another thing, is there's no supernatural threat in House of the Dragon. It's all about Aegon's conquest. So there's no kind of, like, otherworldly factor in there that... Because for most of these epic fantasy shows, even though Game of Thrones kind of broke new ground in terms of, like, being more grounded in reality, the fantasy elements that were there were very important in getting people kind of invested in what was happening. Because, like, up until, you know, the ruinous season 8, you were really looking forward to seeing the battle between the undead and you know, the living. And so, like, you need something kind of larger than life in order to get that, capture that kind of excitement again. So I think that the lack of uncertainty, the lack of, you know, is this person going to survive or not, like that type of thing, and the lack of a supernatural threat from elsewhere, all that combines to what's going to essentially be kind of a boring show, I think.
Mm. I get that. I agree with it to a certain point, but I also think that there's a big enough audience out there that aren't familiar enough with the way things are supposed to go with this show that are going. Those are the ones that HBO are going to plan on watching this show. So I mean, I'm not like if there was a show about Darth Vader, I'm going to watch Darth Vader. I'm going to watch that show. I know he doesn't die until Return of the Jedi, but I'm still going to want to watch his adventures.
It was called the Prequel Trilogy.
Yeah, but you know, if it was something set between those.
That's a little bit different, though, because it's based around a single character. Part of the thing that made Game of Thrones so popular was there was a large group of characters that different people could latch onto. So, like, if you didn't like Jon Snow, you might like Daenerys or vice versa. So, you know, I just feel like this is a big misstep. And I think one of the big reasons why House of the Dragon got greenlit by HBO is because, you know, there was that book, Fire and Blood, that they could pull from for source material. And the big issues with the original Game of Thrones series was that when they ran out of books to pull from, the show got really bad. So
I think they can still play with the multiple characters in the show. They can have Aegon be one of the characters, but of course we're probably going to have at least a main character from every house, every major house. So
point was that the politicking is what made Game of Thrones such a fascinating show for people to watch. And in medieval politics, you know, like assassinations and stuff like that were a big thing. I think that there was one instance where someone tried to assassinate Aegon, which was the Dornish people. But other than that, he was just kind of like, you know, just running roughshod over people. And that doesn't come until much later in his story. So the real question is like, you know, is this just going to cover Aegon's time with conquering Westeros? Or are we going to go past that? Is it covering all of the Targaryen dynasty? Like, there's just a lot of stuff that I think that they're kind of trapped by doing a prequel as opposed to going forward. And I think that's the same with all these Hollywood things where they get stuck in these prequel mentalities where it's like, well, we already have these ideas for what happens. We should show it as opposed to like, hey, let's come up with something new and forge ahead and create new stuff for people to enjoy.
That's valid. That's completely valid. I still think it's going to be a decent show. I think it'll be still fun to watch because despite people knowing the books of Game of Thrones, the first couple of seasons for me were fantastic and they were so much fun to watch, even though a lot of the people that I knew had already read the books and were like, oh yeah, I've already seen all this. I knew what was going to happen. I knew about the Red Wedding. I knew about this. I knew about that. And I'm like, I was completely surprised. I had no idea. So
honestly, like I'd like them to seem like, I'd like to have seen them do like a limited series of the Hedge Knight. I think the Hedge Knight books are really good. And that's basically George R. R. Martin's like short story prequels to the events of Game of Thrones. And it follows Sir Duncan the Tall, who was one of the greatest Kingsguards. And it kind of shows his early beginnings. And his squire was actually young Aegon. In the show, he's Aegon the Unlikely, the eighth son of an eighth son. And he ends up becoming king. And it's basically like he's initially a squire to this Hedge Knight. And through their adventures, Aegon learns all these attributes of being a great leader. And he's actually the brother of the Maester of the Night's Watch, Master Aemon. Aemon even in the show talked to Jon about having to sit out while his family was basically slaughtered and stuff like that. But he was the brother of Aegon the Unlikely. And I think that would have been a really cool kind of, you know, don't make a full series out of it, make it a limited series, and we could kind of see this story. And while you're doing that, develop something new that you can do in that world.
I can see that. Two things. One, this main character, Aegon Targaryen, has two sisters who he's banging. Yeah. So we're gonna get more incest.
Yeah, incest seems
he's banging his sisters?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He married
him. I guess I missed that part of that little video.
Did you miss all the references to it during the, show, too?
No, probably.
Because that was Jaime and Cersei's big justification was that, you know, Targaryens wed brother to sister for generations and nobody ever batted an eye, but, you know, they start doing it and people are like, oh, this is terrible. But, yeah, people have a weird incest fetish thing going on these Game of Thrones shows.
I'm not happy about that because then, of course, there's going to be people who are fans of the characters and they're like, oh, I love that they're together. I'm like, you're freaking creepy. and then the other thing is, what's west of Westeros? I want to know what's going on with Arya.
I want to know the adventures of Arya, the explorer.
The adventures of the faceless girl.
I never liked Arya, so I have no interest in that.
You're such a downer.
Jeez. She was one of my least favorite characters in the books, too.
She's going to go west, find some islands. She's going to infect them all with polio or something. Destroy their population.
Oh, man.
Well, I mean, I think didn't Euron Greyjoy already find that out? Didn't he sail west?
He sailed.
I don't know, man. I didn't read the books.
No, he did.
He said it in the show. He said, "I'm the best sailor in the seven seas or whatever."
Christ, I gotta go.
Eight seas.
Well, watch the series.
Well, when he was exiled from the Iron Islands, that's where he just sailed west. But then he cut out the tongues of all of his crewmates, so they couldn't share his secrets. Of what he learned out there.
That was not in the show. The only thing that hinted towards that in the show is that one random line he says something about like, yeah, these guys are awfully quiet. It's nice to have somebody to talk to.
Yeah.
And that was it. Like they give no explanation at all to Euron's character or who his crew is or nothing, but that one little line.
Because like in the books, he sails west and he finds this this horn that can control dragons, this magic horn. And basically, he uses his control of this horn to win the King's Moot and become King of the Iron Islands. And I mean, like, there's like this whole big subplot of how the Iron Islands choose Euron as their king and stuff like that in the books. And it's very interesting stuff.
In the show, he just made a dick joke, and that was it, right?
Pretty much. Like the Euron in the show is very different from the Euron in the books.
Yeah,
like they kind of took three different characters from the books and combined them into one character for the show, but they didn't even use any of the traits from those three characters. They just kind of made this character his own thing. But they're actually like the sons of Balon Greyjoy. Are like one of them's a priest, one of them is you know a psychopath, and the other one's kind of like a pretty capable admiral, and they're all kind of off doing their own thing. in the books, and it's very fascinating how the Iron Islands kind of develop in the overall story in the books.
Make me 1,000 ships with all the trees that you see on this island. That show was so stupid at the end. Anyway, all right, so our main topic, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening to the movie news portion of this podcast. Now we're going to be discussing a full spoilers discussion of a one-year-old show. I didn't know it was a year old already. When you told me about it, I thought it was like new, and then I found
out. I did too.
I found out it came out like a year ago. So this podcast is a bit late, but that's all right.
It's still fun to watch.
Yeah,
like this is something you could watch every Halloween and be happy with.
Yeah. Oh no, I'm never watching this show.
No. It's okay.
I'm very proud that you watched it to begin with.
So speaking of that, Kadesh, set this up for us. What was it that made you tell us that we needed to watch the show and talk about it?
All right. So my girlfriend is a huge fan of Halloween. It's one of her favorite holidays, and so in the month of October, from the beginning to the end, she makes me watch nothing but spooky, scary horror stuff. And I'm not a big fan of horror movies. I mean, I can appreciate them, but they're not my cup of tea, typically. And last year, around this time, Netflix released a show called The Haunting of Hill House. And it was basically a miniseries adaptation of, you know, the classic novel, which was adapted to multiple like movie versions over time. And so last Halloween, we were like, hey, let's watch the show. It looks really creepy. And I was just bowled over by how good the show was. Like it legitimately spooky, legitimately creepy, but also it had a lot of heart. It was a family drama. There were lots of layers to this show that just impressed me to no end. And this is the thing that made me, number one, aware of the creator, Joe Flanagan, who wrote and directed every episode. And basically made me a fan of his. And he's now directing the sequel to The Shining called Dr. Sleep. This show basically just bowled me over. And so this year, again, when October rolled around, my girlfriend was making me watch all these terrible horror movies. And when we were hanging out, I was like, you know, it's October. We should really be doing something like horror themed. And you're like, and both of you guys are like, oh, I don't like horror movies. I'm like, well, there's a show on Netflix called Haunting of Hill House. And I rank it as one of my top five TV shows up there with The Wire and Breaking Bad. It's that good, in my opinion. And you guys, that kind of intrigued you guys. So you decided to roll the dice and give it a watch.
Yep.
And that's how this discussion came about.
All right. So, Vader, what are your thoughts on this TV show?
My thoughts?
Your thoughts. Man, did you like it?
That's what a was very your, broad
just,
question.
Well, go into it, man. Dive deep.
Dive deep. Okay.
This isn't your typical fare, though, right, Matt?
No, this is not my typical fare at all. It wasn't what I expected. The first few episodes I'm watching, I'm really liking it because it was like there's some scary stuff in here. The jump scares and the creep factor was all really up there and off the scale. And I enjoyed the crap out of the show. It got very deep. A lot of it was very hard to watch for me, as you guys probably know, because of some situations that I have going on. And that part of the show was almost therapeutic in a way, knowing that there can be an end to some bad shit that's out there, you know. But the show itself overall, I really enjoyed it. It was not inside my wheelhouse of shows I ever would have watched. I would have saw Haunting of Hill House and I would have said, nope, skip, go to the next one. In fact, I probably did that, knowing that I probably saw it on Netflix and just forgot it, that it was even out there to watch, because that's just what it would have said to me. Don't watch this. It says Haunting on it. And I would have said, nope, forget it. But I'm glad I did. I'm glad we watched it. And it was good. There was some creepy stuff in there, man.
What was your favorite creepy moment?
My favorite creepy moment? Oh, hands down was the tall guy with the cane walking through the hallways and poor little Luke hiding under the bed. Oh, yeah. God, that just... I almost stopped. I was at that point. It's like, okay, I'm done. This is it. I'm not watching any more of this stupid show. I'm glad I kept going. It was good.
Do you have a favorite character? Which one did you connect to the most, or did you think was the most intriguing?
I don't know if I had a favorite character. I kind of liked I can't think of her name now. The girl with the glove. The older sister. The one who had the, she touched things.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about. God, what's her name?
I would never
her,
remember.
Her sister's
name.
Cheryl. So there's Steve, Cheryl.
I just think of her as the hot one.
Luke and Nelly. The hot one.
Yeah, I think she was probably my favorite of the kids.
Oh, I feel terrible for not knowing her name.
Yeah, me too. I'm prepared. Where's all your notes?
They're right here, but I didn't write her name down. Oh, man. Anything else? That's it? But you got any other scary moments that you liked? There,
the scary moments that
what's
I liked.
Your favorite ghost? Was the tall man favorite or like the one that creeped you out the most?
Yeah, he was the creepiest one. Crooked neck.
What did
lady.
You think about the she end? Was the end creepy. Worth the payoff or worth the 9 episodes of wait?
I don't know. I mean, it wasn't the kind of ending that I wanted out of a horror show. It kind of turned into more of a drama, family drama kind of show, which is fine. You know, it's just, I don't know what I wanted. So it ended up fine. You know, I don't know what else to really say about it. Like I said, it was a lot of it was very therapeutic for me in some ways. So I was glad that it ended the way it did.
That's good.
So I try not to spoil anything, but
no, we can
I
spoil
guess
it.
It's been out a year.
Yeah, yeah, we can spoil the crap out of it. Go ahead.
So no, you go ahead.
Oh, okay.
What did you think?
I hate these types of shows. I hate them. I don't like jump scares. I don't like ghosts. I don't like supernatural stuff. And I'm not even a particularly big fan of like family melodramas where everybody's just mad at each other for reasons. So like these. Like shows like Shameless, where everybody's just at each other's throats all the time, and that's a family. Oh, we're together, so we love each other, but we really hate each other, and we talk crap about each other all the time. That kind of got old for me in the early part of the show, where it was just these siblings who just didn't get along, and they were constantly bickering and stuff like that. I was like, okay, I get it. But I did. There was one particular thing that I really enjoyed about this show was the contrast between. The comparison of mental illness to actual supernatural happenings. So my favorite character is actually Steve because I liked his take on things early mm-hmm. on where he was like, you guys are just all crazy. This is a mental illness that's been running on our family. He's the skeptic. And I really like that about him. It's probably because that's how I am. But I was like, that's a really awesome. It was a kind of a good play because you're watching this show and it makes you question like once he puts that opinion out there, you're looking at these characters like, are they really just crazy? Like all these,
yeah.
Because the thing about these ghosts is they never really interacted with you.
Correct. Yes.
It was always like this subtlety thing. Or it was noises, or it was things that you could totally see as being some kind of a mental projection or hallucination.
Early on, he actually kind of defines what a ghost is for the show, and he says a ghost can be guilt, it can be a memory, it can be this and that. So like, it's not necessarily a supernatural manifestation, but it's something that haunts an individual in their mind. And so like the show, even though like there are supernatural elements to it, it kind of uses that definition throughout the entire series to justify like how someone can see something outside of the Hill House or something like that. Mm-hmm. It's something that has taken root in that person's mind, and whether it be guilt or anger or jealousy or memory or something like that.
I did find myself often wondering, especially in the latter half of the series, like, if the ghosts were actually there or not, like you were saying. It's like, are these manifestations of their brain or are these things real? You know, I think I got, I don't know, the crooked neck lady kind of stuff kind of really threw me off too with when she like fell off the balcony and did the flashbacks. The time.
Then I wasn't a fan of that. Because I think they gave it away too soon. Like, mm-hmm. I saw it coming. Like, there was a scene in one of the earlier episodes. It wasn't the Bent Neck Lady episode. It was an earlier episode where you see somebody drop and fall and hang. And it was just a flash, like a one or two frames. And I was like, oh, that's how she's going to die. Because they foreshadowed it again when the mom, Olivia, was looking up at the banisters. She was like, can you take those ropes down? Because there's going to be bodies hanging. I was like, Jesus, how much can you project this into, you know, like, spoil what's going to happen?
I mean... proper writing has set up and payoff. So like I look at that like, yeah, like it foreshadowed it, but it didn't do it like heavy handedly. And it set it up so that like when it was paid off, like it was satisfying to me. Like that to me is, this show is so well written. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a very well-written show, and that's an example of just how well-written it is it actually bothers to set up everything it pays off.
I have to admit, the first time you see people walk up the giant three-story tall spiral staircase up to the iron balcony, I was thinking, it's like, something bad's going to happen there.
It's like everybody died there. It's like the death call of the whole house was that staircase. I understand, like, set up and payoff and stuff like that. I felt like it was a little bit too heavy-handed because it was not subtle in any way. I was watching the show and I was like, oh, Nell is going to hang herself and that's who the bent neck lady is. Like, that, because she has a broken neck from hanging herself. Like, that was like, it was just so easy to connect those dots. And I did it before the show was like supposed to like reveal it to me. Like, you're not supposed to connect these dots yet until this episode.
I didn't connect those dots.
I did. I was okay.
You're way smarter than me.
Well, I'm not smarter. I just was looking at it. I'm like, well, that's obvious. Okay. Anyway, so I wasn't super thrilled with that, although I did really like Nell's character. Her episode where it was kind of her backstory about how she was dealing with these night paralysis episodes, and she met this doctor who was a sleep expert, mm-hmm. and they got married. Like, that whole episode was awesome. I loved that whole episode. And his death and her coming back into the Hill House mythos of being haunted by this bent neck lady – that episode was expert.
Yeah,
like it was shocking and it was tragic. It was amazing. When he died, like, I feel bad saying that, but when he died, I was like, holy cow. And then they revealed the bent neck lady, and then Nell's like, she's the one who did it. She's the reason why it's happened.
Episode of the series.
Yeah, it was by far my favorite.
One of the interesting things about this show is, like, every episode is kind of geared around a different character.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, the first episode, it's like, what's that character's name? Steve?
Steve. Yeah,
and then it goes to the sister in episode 2, and then the other sister in episode 3, and so on and so forth. And it's actually very close to how George R. R. Martin wrote Game of Thrones, where every chapter is like the POV chapter of a different character, where we see things from their perspective. And so Joe Flanagan kind of took that concept and translated it into this series, where each episode is told from a different character's perspective. And even more interesting than that is that, Flanagan actually did some research into how people binge watch TV shows, and he found out that most people watch 3 episodes in one sitting, and so he structured his narrative arc in 3 episode increments. So the first 3 episodes tell one part of the story, the next 3 episodes tell another part of the story, and the final 3 episodes tell, and it's like a 3-act play told in 3 episodes.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, and that just shows like the level of sophistication in terms of like the writing of the show. In fact, there are 2 things I wanted to share with you guys about this show that I found very interesting. So the first thing was that Flanagan, before he really started production on the show, he sat down and he wrote out the history of the house and every ghost that was in it. So like every character that shows up in The Haunting, he had a backstory for. He knew how they died. He knew how they got to the house. He knew he knew all this stuff. Like, he had this huge backstory, all plotted out.
There's like 40 or 50 ghosts in the show,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
At the end?
Like all the main ghosts, pretty much. But for some of the smaller ones, I'm sure like he kind of knew how they got there and stuff like that. But the point is that he constructed a world and he knew this world inside and out. And he actually removed a lot of that from the final scripts because it just kind of bogged things down. But the fact that he knew that just made it so that all this stuff became very real in the show. Like, whenever you see a ghost in the show, they feel very well developed. And one of the reasons for that is, for instance, you know that episode where the kids go down the dumbwaiter and they get trapped in that cellar?
That freaked the frick out of me,
so,
man.
So, like, they knew.
There's
a freaking zombie in the basement. There's a zombie in the basement.
They knew who that zombie was, why they were buried down there, what that cellar was used for. It was used for bootlegging.
Mm-hmm.
And all this stuff, like, they had every justification necessary to make that scene work.
And also, one of the main plots of the show is that they couldn't find the blueprints to this house. And one of the reasons was because of that cellar. When they were bootlegging alcohol during the Prohibition, they didn't want the cops or anybody to know that that room was down there. So they mocked up some fake blueprints for this house, which is why it was just a small thing. But I noticed that. Yeah. And I was like, that's really cool.
But like the tall man ghost, for mm-hmm. instance. Like, there was a whole backstory as to why he's tall like that in death, because like he was a short guy in life and he wanted to be tall. And they kind of explain how all this stuff happened. And even more than that, like, there's even the way that they structure the characters, like every brother and sister in the family represents a different stage of grief.
Mm-hmm. And, took my reveal.
It's these subtle layers that really showcase a talented and skilled storyteller mm-hmm. that are present in this show. And it's something that you don't see a lot, especially in stuff by Benioff and Wiess, you know? I just need to draw a parallel between those two, because these are two guys in their Austin Q&A, Benioff and Wiess specifically said that they didn't understand the characters of the show because it was so big. So they just wrote for the actors. They knew the actors, and they're like, well, the actors know their characters, so we're just going to write for the actors. Whereas with something like Hill House, Flanagan sat down. He's like, okay, these are the characters. I'm going to write for the characters, and the actors will embody the characters that I create. And that's the difference between a skilled storyteller and a hack, is someone who actually understands the material they're working with. Now, the last thing I wanted to mention was that in my research for this, I actually found out that there was an alternate ending to this this show.
Oh, thank God, because I hated this ending.
Probably would have been the ending I like better.
Well, actually, like, I thought the ending of the show was brilliant. But basically, so the ending happens as you know, you see the family kind of move on with their lives and heal and stuff like that. And Luke recovers from his drug addiction. And, you know, Steve has his family and all this other stuff. And originally, the ending was going to be like, we see all that, and then we cut back to the Red Room, and they're all still there. And it was all just a fantasy.
Oh, see, that would have been perfect.
What?
I would have loved that.
Really?
Yeah.
No. That's like,
now we're getting into some Halloween horrors.
The whole like, it's all a dream thing? No.
Well, it wasn't all a dream. It was the fact that they were still trapped in the house and that their happy ending was just an illusion.
They're being digested. And
they're being
slowly
digested by the house. So it was a lot darker and more of a horror ending.
Yeah,
But Flanagan basically said, you know, over the course of making the show, I came to really care about these characters. And I didn't want to give them a shitty ending. I wanted to give them a happy ending.
One of the things I know, he said something about when he was asked about this, the next show or season two, he's like, are they going to have the cranes in this next show? And he said, no, I think they've been through enough.
Yeah. Since you probably did your research on the ghosts more so than us, tell us about the clock repair guy. Does he have a story?
Hold on. I gotta talk about that because... That episode, that was one of the best reveals.
Yeah.
Because I know for a fact that he's in a shit ton of these episodes.
He is.
And I never saw him once until they said, the man in the clock is not a real person. Yeah. You were seeing a ghost. And I was like, wait, what? 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 I went back and looked at all these other episodes and I was like, holy shit, I never even noticed him.
The level of subtlety in the show. Like, I watched a YouTube video that kind of broke down every time we see a ghost in the background.
It's crazy.
There's like something like 30 different ghosts like that are just like kind of out of focus in the background. Like you see them in the show, but like you don't register them. And it's just fascinating, like because it just adds to the creepiness. Like there's always someone in that house watching these characters.
Yeah.
And it just unnerves you, you know? Like the whole thing is just so well done. Even like one of the things I love most about this show is like it's a really good example of horror done right. Because to me, like, I don't like a lot of gore. I don't like a lot of, you know, cheap scares. But like everything in this show, like, it creates an atmosphere. It creates a genuinely creeped out feeling. Like you know, there are lots of scenes where like you just get goosebumps because it's so tense. And they do have like the jump scares and stuff like that. But the jump scares are really well done.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not just thrown in for the sake of trying to scare the audience.
There was only a couple, and I think it was very early on, either the first or second episode, that they purposely did like quick, sudden edits. That weren't there. It was like a moment where it was like trying to build tension, and then they cut real fast to somebody turning on a light switch. It was supposed to make you jump, and I was like, "I hate that stuff."
Yeah,
the one jump scare that I liked the most was when the two sisters were in the car driving to the Hill House, and Nell comes dead out Nell. Of the back, the dead Nell comes out of the back seat, and just screams like that.
It's like basically
freaked me
quit
out.
Quit arguing.
Yeah, exactly. Which I thought was really cool because the ghosts weren't necessarily there to freak these people out. At least not Nell herself. But she was the only time that she ever interacted with them is when she was mad at them for arguing with each other. Like at the scene in the funeral home. Where she knocks over the casket because the family is arguing.
That episode is truly brilliant.
Oh, yeah, we can talk about that. The single shot episode.
But before we get to that,
All right, so there's a couple of things that I didn't like. It was specifically about Luke's character. Everybody else, like you said, masterly written. All the characters are really good, perfect. Everything was satisfying. Everything made sense. Except for Luke. Luke, when he's a kid, and this is a nitpicky thing, but Luke, when he's a kid, has like bottle cap glasses. Like he's super blind. And they show it several times, and they even make a thing about it during the Tall Man episode where he puts his glasses on so he could see the door. And they actually did the whole like fuzzy, you know, can't unfocused vision. And then when he puts his glasses on, the room comes into focus. So it's very obvious that this kid can't see. That is never addressed again with the adult version of Luke. He's not in any way impaired by bad vision. So did he just use his junkie money to go get LASIK? Or did he sell some heroin and like somebody fixed his eyeballs for him? Does he have contacts on? Like there's never any mention of that. And I was like, well, why have it be such a dominant trait for this young character and then have no likeness to it when he's older? That didn't make any sense to me. And there was another thing about Luke. This writer must not have liked Luke. Because all the other characters in this show, when they go back to Hill House, the house itself and the ghost within it cannot physically, or maybe they don't physically interact with these characters. They can knock things over, they can make noises, they can do things, they can look under the bed like the Tall Man did, but they never touch the live people. Both Olivia, when she died, she didn't get pushed off the balcony. She jumped on her own will. It was Poppy Hill, the main ghost with the red hair, who persuaded her to do so because it was part of the theme of like, you know, being awake versus being dead, and death being safer than the real world is kind of what the whole plot was about, with these characters wanting to commit suicide. And then the same thing happened with Nell. Nell went to the house. She was hallucinating. She found out, you know, she saw her husband downstairs, and she jumped. She realized at the last second what she was doing, and she tried to stop herself, but the ghost never touched her. She was never pushed. Same thing with all the other characters. Even Hugh, the father, who has arguably spent the most time in that house dealing with these beings. But then in Luke goes to the house. He's 90 days sober. He's not on any kind of drug. He's not having any issues like that at that moment. He goes to the house to burn it down because he wants to get rid of this house. The house physically stops him and grabs him and drags him up to the red room to digest him, which I was like, well, he didn't have a hallucination. Literally a ghost came up behind him and grabbed him by the head. And then the scene cut. So you have to assume that it dragged him up to that room. So all of a sudden these ghosts are interacting physically with these characters. And then the second thing, when he is in the room and he's hallucinating that he's with his girlfriend, the drug addict. What was I saying? Oh, yeah. Because so he's in the red room and he's hallucinating. He's with his girlfriend. And she is trying to convince him to shoot up one last time before they get better. But he's already 90 days sober. And he doesn't want to do it. He tells her no. And then the house just miraculously gives him a needle in his arm without him knowing it. And I was like, okay, well, that goes against his character. He had already said no to her. Didn't want to do it. And now the house is poisoning him to get him to die. So the house is physically interacting with him in order to kill him. And then again, in the last bit of scene, after he's like, he's in kind of in purgatory, or he's in the red room, he sees his mother and she tries to get him to take the hat, the big boy hat, you know, come with us, stay with us forever, come to the tea party. He says no again. And it's like Luke is constantly telling this house, no, you have no power over me. But the house is just forcing him to do it. And the only person that saves him in the end is Nell, who drags him out of that hallucination and wakes him up and saves his life. Which I thought it was completely inconsistent for them to have all these rules set up for all the other characters, but then break all of those rules for Luke.
Well, there's an argument to be made that, so it was set up earlier on that the house can, in fact, interact with people. Like, remember when, Nell goes missing as like a young girl, like the whole family's there and all of a sudden she disappears.
Yeah, but nobody grabbed her and took her. She was in that room still.
They didn't show.
Luke's flashback. Shirt was ripped when he went down the dumbwaiter when he came back up.
There was a flashback where
he said it got caught, or the parents said it got caught on something, remember?
Yeah, but they were.
Yeah,
yeah,
you
know.
but there was a flashback, I think it was in the one shot episode where Nell basically disappears. And it's implied that the ghost took her. And so the family's like all searching for it. And then, you know, at some point she just shows back up. She does, I don't know where I was.
That was the single shot episode, right?
Yeah. So there is some setup for the fact that if you're in the house has a certain amount of power that it can exert over you. So Luke getting dragged up to the Red Room and stuff like that, that's not out of the realm of possibility because they kind of set up that the house can do that earlier on. Now, in terms of, you know, all of a sudden having, you know, the needle in his arm and stuff like that, there's an argument to be made that all that stuff is a hallucination, that none of it's actually happening, but because it's in his head, he has these reactions. And like when the family comes and finds him in that room, he might just be like knocked out, passed out, but it looks like he's OD'd or something like that.
Steve pulled the needle out of his arm.
But I mean, like, if you look at that, every time they were in that red room, it manifested as a different thing with stuff that they interacted with, whether it be TVs or lunchboxes or whatever. That room can create stuff, okay? And because that room is like the center of the house's power, it makes sense that anything in that room creates is tangible. So if you're in that room, then that's where you're in the most danger because that room can do anything to you, pretty much. So there's an argument to be made for that. I totally understand your criticism of it, and I think that's perfectly valid criticism. But there's also a counter argument to all the points you brought up.
Cool. Do you have anything to add?
No.
No. I love you, man.
Yeah, I think you guys covered it.
All right. So I remember what I forgot I wanted to mention beforehand, which was one of the great things about this show is just how well it's able to create stuff that's truly scary and horrific, but it's not in your face about it. Like there's that one scene where the psychic daughter, the psychic girl, she's in bed and like she hears some scraping from like outside her bedroom door, and she's in bed with her sister and she's like holding her sister's hand because like her sister's hand's kind of like draped around her chest. Mm-hmm. And like she's like holding her hand like they're kind of snuggled together in bed, and you think that the scary thing is coming from like outside the room where they're gonna open the door, and she's like, she's getting all scared and she's like grabbing onto her sister's hand, and then the door opens and it's her sister who went out to get like a glass of water or something like that, and she like sits up and she's like whose hand was I holding? And it was like there was like a ghost in bed with her.
See,
that
now
whole time.
I got the impression that was the daughter that had the feelings where she could touch things. Now, I got the impression that she got that ability to sense things and feel things with her hand because she was physically holding hands with that ghost who was in bed with her arm around her.
It's quite possible.
So that's the impression.
Theodora.
That's how I took that.
Theodora.
Her name is Theodora. Theo.
So basically, my point was is like that's a perfect scene. Like that scene has like stuck with me from watching the show, and it's such a creepy.
Yeah,
freaking thing! Like when you sit up and you're like, "Whose hand was I holding?"
Yeah. It was like,
and that's also another example of the ghost physically interacting with the people.
Damn it!
Because she was holding that ghost.
Yeah,
but I mean, like, there's so much stuff like that in the show. Like, for instance, like when they find like the baby kittens, and the bug crawls out of.
Oh God,
mouth.
Those kittens
that scared
creepy.
The shit out of me.
Like, there's so much wonderful horror imagery in this, and it's not. It's not like stuff like people getting their guts torn out of them.
No.
And like, you know, the killer's stabbing someone. It's all very atmospheric. It's all very subtle. It's all like truly like it's horror done right, in my opinion.
It was funny because I wanted so badly to hate this show. I was watching it, and Cheryl, the girl who ends up being the funeral home director, when it was before they kind of revealed why she did what she did. It was an earlier episode, or maybe it was just the beginning of the episode where she had this tragic, this horrific vision with these cats that were like supposed to be dead, or they were dead and they opened their eyes and it was like this horror thing, like super creepy. And she had this weird relationship with her mom's death and how she handled that. And I'm watching this and I'm like, why the hell does this girl run a funeral home? Like, that is the last thing somebody who had this kind of trauma would do. Like, she would want nothing to do with death and funerals and dead bodies and all this stuff. And then they revealed they had this little writing cue with the funeral director for her mom's funeral, where he said something about, like, we help people fix this. We help people fix their dead loved ones so that they look like they used to look like, so they don't have to deal with that trauma. And I was like, there it is.
Yep.
I was like,
she became a funeral director because she wanted whacked to out in the head.
Yeah, because she wanted to fix other people's visions trauma. Of trauma and in some way try and fix her own, which I was like, okay, all right, God damn it, I like this show.
Yeah, one of the great things about this show, and I think it's also one of your biggest criticisms of it, was that it is at its core like a family melodrama. And every character in this show has like an arc, mm-hmm. and they develop it. And it's something that is so rare in Hollywood nowadays, where you actually have a show that, or just a story in general, that takes its characters so seriously and bothers to give them each and every one of them actual fully realized character.
Yeah,
arc.
It's like Steve, the skeptic, right? The I don't believe guy.
Yeah.
But he makes his living writing ghost stories.
The Stephen King character.
Maybe. Yeah. He makes his living writing ghost stories, but he does it to be able to explain away.
Yeah.
What these ghosts are.
Yeah. So. I like. He's still my favorite character. Like, he's kind of a jerk most of the season, but I like his take. I also talked about before.
Theo, like her whole thing about not being able to be intimate with people or trust them.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a great subplot with her where she basically, she's kind of a counselor for young children.
Mm-hmm.
And she finds clues that there's this girl who's being abused by her foster mm-hmm. father. And she kind of goes there and she tracks down and she's unafraid to face like real monsters in the world. And I found that very kind of poignant as well. And also, we got to talk about the father, because the father's character is very interesting as well. Because we go back to this notion of, where the show has this kind of broad definition of ghost about like guilt, and sometimes a ghost can be a memory and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And we see the father, he keeps having conversations with his dead wife. And you're like, is that really her ghost, or is that his memory of her? How like what is that? And I personally have the belief that it was his memory, and then when he gets back into the house, that's the real ghost.
Yeah.
Yep. But his character is absolutely fascinating as well, because if you look at like what drives him, like his whole thing, because he was a house flipper and stuff like that, he just wants to fix stuff.
Yep.
Right.
That's his driving motivation, is he's the fixer. And everything he does in the show is to fix something terrible that happened. And the ultimate climax of the show is him fixing his family. And it was so beautiful and it was so poetic. Like, he makes the ultimate sacrifice for his children because he wants to fix this trauma that he inadvertently inflicted upon them. And it was beautiful to me. And I think that that's one of the reasons why I feel like this show is on a different level, is because of the characters that you come to care about and their relationships with each other. And it is a bit melodramatic, but at the end of the day, it all works. It all makes sense. And it all fits together perfectly. And it's the sign of a really, truly great storyteller.
Yeah, it was definitely one of the first series in a long time that I've watched it. I was actually intrigued from the beginning to the end. That had an actual story to tell. That had a satisfactory conclusion.
Yeah.
At the end. You know, it was nice. It was all wrapped up in a nice
everything they set up. 10 episode bundle.
Yeah, it was great.
Yeah, I have to agree with that. Even though the ending to me felt a little sappy, like we talked about.
Yeah.
It did feel a little sappy, and I was kind of like, okay, well, one of the things about this show, that especially shows like this, that I don't particularly like is the setup and payoff. Like, the setup and payoff is really good and it works. However, I felt like they stretched it out almost too long, because it was kind of like the carrot on the stick thing for me. And I hate carrots on sticks, man. They dangle this payoff in front of you, like, oh, are you going to find out this episode? Oh, maybe you'll find out next episode. Oh, what does this mean? Maybe you'll find out next episode. And I'm like, Jesus, just freaking tell me already. It's so irritating. And then they did eventually explain everything away at in the finale.
This is not a mystery box.
Which, no. Yes, this is not.
Like, they pose these questions that you want to know the answer to, but they eventually give you the answers.
They do.
Good answers.
Yeah.
It's not like a J.J. Abrams or Damon Lindelof type thing.
I do.
We're going to do something weird, and we're never going to explain it.
This is the kind of show that's perfect for a thing like Netflix to do.
Yeah.
Because you can get the whole thing done in 10 episodes.
Yeah, if I had to wait week by week.
And and you don't have to ever watch it again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I can't remember specifically. There was like one character thing that they were kind of like hinting at or trying to, you know, dangle in front of you that they were going to pay off. And I was like, can you just pay it off already? Otherwise, I'm not going to care. Like, and some of the things, like by the time the finale came, I was like, I just didn't care about some of these, some of the payoffs. I was like, whatever, I don't care anymore. And one of the things I thought was weird, Cheryl is the only one that had a ghost that wasn't involved with the house. Her ghost was of guilt.
It was guilt.
Yeah. It was her ghost was guilt, but it hadn't
cheated on her husband.
Yeah, it had nothing to do with Hill House, which I thought was interesting. Not a bad thing. It was just different. I was like, oh, okay, that's weird. Like I didn't expect that to happen.
Well, one of the interesting things about this show is like its use of ghost as theme and metaphor, and basically, you know, that broad definition that they set up, where a ghost can be guilt, it can be a memory, it can be, you know, jealousy, like all this stuff. All that is explored in this show. Like there's various different forms of ghosts beyond just the supernatural in this show. And I think that's what makes it so fascinating.
Yeah.
But of course, there is, of course, the supernatural ghost in this show, which is also what makes it fun. But the biggest thing that impresses me most about this show is just like how great it was on a technical level. Like, let's talk about that one episode.
God, good segue.
Yeah. There's this one episode, I believe it's episode 7, 6.
Yeah, it's like towards the end. It's
7, I think.
Yeah. Where basically they're having the funeral for Nell. And it's all done in these really long shots, like one take shots. And they're kind of melded to make it look like the entire episode is one take. But Joe Flanagan basically said, hey, I want to try and do an entire episode in just one long shot. And they spent something like 6 months rehearsing for this thing. Because, I mean, like, you go into, like, different sets and, like, you replace actors and stuff like that. Like, it's truly, on a technical level, it's truly it's one of the most masterful episodes of TV I think I've ever seen, just on a logistical level, where all the actors and all the crew members and all the sets and stuff like that have to be in perfect synchronization. Because if even one thing messes up, the whole thing has to...
It was bizarre how they would, like, make transitions from the funeral home.
That was all one set.
Yeah.
It was crazy. Yeah. It was super fun.
Once you told me about it, I watched the documentary on how they did it and stuff like that. And it was totally cool. Cause
I
you
still
could,
need to do that.
You could see, like, they said, like, hey, we built this funeral homes over here, and then it connected in various passageways and like secret doors and walls that will open for crew members and stuff like that is all connected to the Hill House set. So you have these people running around. And one of the things that they talked about was the hardest thing is at some point in time, Olivia becomes possessed by the house, and she just kind of pops up out of nowhere in multiple different areas. And because there's no cuts, they didn't have any way of, like, you can't just teleport the actor. So they have like 6 or 7 different extras all for Olivia, and they pop up in different parts of the house. And then when it's actually the actor who has like a close-up scene, she pops up in specific areas. And
the crazy super thing cool. about it is, like, you know how we were talking about how they hide ghosts in the shots, even in that episode where it was just like one long take, you see like just like these hidden ghosts just like standing there, and like they do these subtle things, like they'll like move like statues like in the house and stuff like that, and it's all done in one take.
Yeah,
and you're like, when I saw that episode for the first time, I was like, holy God, this is incredible. And it, you know, it's something that your average TV viewer probably wouldn't really appreciate, but if you're like someone who's like a cinema junkie and you're like into like the behind the scenes inside baseball stuff, that one episode, like, that's something that you could teach a class on in film school about, just on the sheer logistics of how you plan something like that, how you execute something like that. I mean, that episode to me truly elevated this show from like good to amazing.
Yeah.
And it's one of the reasons why I'm a huge Joe Flanagan fan right now, is because I think that he is definitely one of the talents in Hollywood.
What else does he have out there?
So he did a couple of movies, like Gerald's Game for Netflix, which starred the same actress who played the mother in this one.
Oh, Olivia. Okay.
And he also did one. Actually, the actress who plays Theo, I think, is his wife, and he did a movie with her where she was deaf, and there was like a guy who was like stalking her in her house. But he also did Oculus and a couple other, like one other Blumhouse horror movie. But his latest one is this Dr. Sleep, Stephen King adaptation.
Oh, that's him.
That's him.
Okay.
And if I had to choose one person to kind of pick up Kubrick's torch, it would be him. Because he's not going to try to emulate Kubrick, but he's going to try to capture the stuff that made the original Shining so freaking scary.
The atmosphere.
And put it in his movie. Because, I mean, he is a truly intelligent filmmaker and storyteller. He's someone who sits down, he thinks things through, he plans things out, he layers in, like, various themes and stuff like that. So, like, I went back and watched, you know, some of his earlier movies, and you can see the kernels of brilliance in there. Like they're all, like, very solid films. They're not truly, like, great films, but they're solid. And Hill House was, like, his first kind of, because he had such a wide tapestry with which to tell a story with, it really, I think, showcased his talent in a way that none of his other films have. And I can't tell you how impressed I am with this guy. Like, I follow him on Twitter. I think that he is one of the big up-and-comers in Hollywood. Give this guy a Star Wars film.
There you have it, folks.
Yeah.
A horror Star Wars film?
No, just a Star Wars film. Because that's a great thing. Like, if you can do one genre really good, you can typically do other genres good, too.
I'm down for it. I mean, you know, Star Wars, it's no longer, like, we're going to switch subjects. We're going to close out real quick, folks. But you just mentioned something that made me think, like, Star Wars is no longer George Lucas's baby. That story is told, the Skywalker story, the saga, the family drama, the space opera. I wouldn't be opposed to them branching out and having different types of genre Star Wars movies. And if this guy wants to do something in the horror suspense, but based in Star Wars, I mean, why not? Go for it.
Well, let him do a Disney Plus series Star Wars. I mean, like, look at what he did with Hill House. This was probably the best adaptation of that book I've ever seen, and it had nothing to do with the book.
Yeah, it was completely
like,
different.
Like, normally I'm like, respect the source material. But like, with this, like the source material was just basically, like, the concept, and they threw everything else out. But, like, if you've seen the Hill House, other movies like The Haunting with Liam Neeson,
that was such a – that's the same – there's been, like, four movies about this book?
Yeah.
Okay, because way back when, there was a freaking scary movie. It was something about Hill House, Haunted Hill House or something like that.
It was a black and white movie.
There was that one, and then there was another one in the early 2000s with the chick who played Jean Grey from X-Men. And
Famke Janssen.
Yeah, and a couple other people in it. And that movie probably isn't very scary, but when I was a kid and I watched it, it scared the crap out of me.
I think you're thinking of House on Haunted Hill.
Yes.
That's a different story.
Thing?
Yeah, that's different. Basically, I think The Haunting of Hill House has been adapted like three times. One of them was the classic black and white original 1950s movie. Mm-hmm. And then you had the Jan de Bont early 90s adaptation with Liam Neeson, Luke Wilson, and Catherine Zeta-Jones, which was basically just a demo effects reel with a feature-length running time, because it was not scary at all. But, you know, the book itself is kind of one of those things where it's very psychological. And I think that they basically just took the overall concept of this haunted house and the psychological impact of haunting and translated it into a brilliant TV show. And so, like, I think that from my perspective, like, Joe Flanagan, like, he's a guy who's proven that he can plot things out. He's a good writer, that he cares about characters, and that he can logistically handle a very complicated production. And so that's exactly what Star Wars needs, is someone who can do that type of stuff.
I'm all for it. Final thoughts, Matt Vader?
Nope.
Perfect.
I'm good.
All right, folks.
I would say everyone needs to watch Haunting of Hill House.
Yes, for sure. Despite my saltiness about some of the issues with that show and the fact that I'm not really a big horror fan, it is a worthy show to watch. It will not waste your time. It's enjoyable. It's scary. It's everything that you would want in a horror show. All right. Well, thanks everybody for listening to the Salty Nerd Podcast. Tune in next week where we will be talking about something else. I don't know yet.
Be talking about stuff.
Stuff.
I'm sure there'll be news come out
the
day before.
Yeah.
You know,
like, dude, how awesome was that?
Yeah.
Like, I was like, the only thing I have to talk about this week is Hill House, and then like the last 2 days has been like Star Wars, Game of Thrones, like, this and that.
All the good stuff comes out on Monday, so like gives us the day to
perfect.
Watch YouTube videos about it and stuff, you know.
All right, everybody. Have a good day. Thanks for listening.
do.